This is a black and white camera, and this is Wigby. Now Wigby is standing in a nice field, so why don't we take a picture of him? It's black and white, but what if I told you, and you might want to sit down for this, we could take color pictures before. When I first found out about this, I thought, well, that's impossible, right? Capturing color probably requires a completely different technology. But the thing is, it doesn't. Okay, so first we gotta change how we look at a black and white image. Instead of seeing it as an image with no color, we need to see it as an image that only shows brightness. So Wigby's hat here isn't white, but rather bright. And the same goes for the water. It's basically a spectrum of brightness. This can also be called luminance, but we're gonna get back to that. But let's set that aside for a bit. Let's look at the same image, but in color. Digital images are made up of these tiny squares called dots. Just kidding, I'm talking about pixels. Now pixels are made up of three different values, being red, green and blue, which are the same as the spectrum I mentioned on the grayscale image, except here, each spectrum here refers to the brightness level of a single color. So essentially, a digital color image has three separate brightness levels for each pixel, also known as the RGB values. But what if we split this into three different images, each with a different spectrum? Here's what you get. One image for red, green and blue. It's the most obvious on Wigby. You can see that we separated the colors of the image. What we did is, we kept one of the spectrums and made the others completely dark by setting their values to zero. So now, these images only show the brightness of their respective colors and don't contain the others at all. In fact, they don't even need to be colorful like this. They could just be grayscale and the information is still the same because all we need is the brightness. But the important thing here is that we can put these back together. We simply need to do the opposite of what we just did. Take each of these images and apply their brightness information to the RGB values of the new image. The easiest way to do this digitally is to open a somewhat advanced image editor, put all three of your images on different layers, and set their blend mode to additive. Though you do need them to be colored this time. What this does is, it's gonna add up the red, green and blue values, giving us the complete picture. Now color blending like this is in a league of its own, which is why it's gonna be the topic of next week's video. So if that sounds interesting to you, then you should probably subscribe. Okay, so we can split the color image up and put it back together. But how do we use this? Well, let's go back to the camera. So it captures black and white images, which as I mentioned is simply a level of brightness. The way it works is, it has a whole bunch of these little light detectors and they detect the amount of light that hits them, which is then translated into an image, each detector corresponding to one pixel. Now this is where we need to use filters. Well, color filters. See, the camera detects brightness, right? And the color filter only lets a certain color of light pass through. So now if we put a green filter in front of the camera, now it detects the brightness of green. Which, as you hopefully remember from earlier, is one of the images we would get after splitting the image into three different colors. The brightness spectrum now shows us the amount of green, so if we do this for red and blue as well, then combine them, we get a beautiful picture of Wigby. We're gonna be using this later. Now, of course, modern cameras don't have three lenses like this. Well, they kinda do, but that's different. It's more like a bunch of cameras that are intertwined. Look at this, for example. It's a small camera with red filters in front of the detectors. These are moved apart, and another set of detectors are placed, now with a blue filter. Two more sets are added and now in green. And that's how we get the barrier pattern. Which I think would look great on a shirt, by the way. This is the closest thing I could find, but I prefer the pattern to be much smaller so it's easier on the eyes. Oh, and the reason there are twice as many green dots here is because we are more sensitive to green light. Like, way more. Actually, we have different sensitivities for each color. This is why, oddly enough, turning a color image into black and white is almost a little more complicated than the opposite. Hopefully you kept that picture of Wigby because we're gonna turn that back into black and white. So you probably remember how it looked, and it was something like this. But getting this result is trickier than it seems. If you ever messed around with colors, you probably noticed that while most colors have an RGB value like this, all shades of gray, including black and white, have the same values. Which means we effectively have a single spectrum here. So we have this color image now that we want to turn black and white. Well, we need to take separate color values and turn them into a single number. The obvious methods here failed spectacularly, which I think is amazing. My first attempt for this was to just take one of the values, such as red, and apply that to the others. This should be fine, right? And yeah, it looks fine on a normal picture, but Wigby wouldn't agree. Attempting the same with green and blue doesn't help, but funnily enough, this is how we get the three images I mentioned earlier. My second attempt was, after noticing my mistake of not taking all the colors into account, was to get the average. Red plus green plus blue divided by 3. Well, that looks better, right? I mean, I guess, but again, the normal picture looks fine. But Wigby here once again exposes the problem. There is no contrast between the colors, which mathematically makes sense, but it still doesn't look right. Luckily, Wigby brought a friend, called Luminance. Yeah, not exactly a creative name, but we don't judge. See, luminance is great, because it's basically how bright a color is. Well, at least to us humans. If you have a color changing light, you can actually see this quite clearly. Under blue light, everything is dark and unclear. Under red light, it's a lot more clear, but it's still dark. Now in green light, you can see everything quite easily. As long as they're green. But Luminance here brought a bag with just what we need. A formula. Okay, it's a little detailed, but it is simple. You can clearly see, pun intended, that there's quite a difference between these multipliers. This is similar to just taking their average, but here we're giving them different weights. And green is clearly the winner here, followed by a respectable red and, well, that's just embarrassing blue. But the resulting value, which is called the luminance, is exactly what we need to create a new gray color. But now let's see how it looks on Wigby. Well, there you go. It's so much better. You can see where the colors meet and you can even make out which color is which. Almost. So hopefully we gained a new appreciation for black and white images and found it as fascinating as I do. I personally love it, because neither part is as obvious as it seems at first. And make sure to tune in next week for color blending. Again, more to it than it seems.